you for having me over here. I'm very nervous, as you can see, in this list of illustrious speakers. I'm somebody who's just followed my passion, and that's what I'm here for. I'm a food blogger. I bake a lot. Everything I know is about food currently. I've done my honors in economics, and it makes no sense to me. Just who I am. Okay, I've come with stories in my head, food stories, incidents that have changed my life. And to talk about food matters at a macro level, and at a very micro level, how food matters to me. And basically, just to get you guys thinking about what you eat every day and what's on your plate, and looking beyond what we do every day. I'm not here to talk about desserts, as you might see. Those are pictures I've taken, things that are common in here. There's something common to the four pictures that you see back there. They're all desserts. Yes, they've all been made by me. I've styled and shot them all. That's what I like to do. They're on my blog. The only common thing that it doesn't have is plain flour, which is my biggest personal grudge and like my punching bag, because I think it's synonymous to empty calories, things that we eat excessively and things that do no good to us or our well-being. And that's what I want you guys to start thinking about. What goes onto your plate and how good it is for you at the end of the day. The first cake is flourless, it's a dark chocolate cake. The second one is a cheesecake made with quark. It's a cheese that I make at home often. The third is a tapioca chocolate pudding, which is a sabudana pudding. Very nice, no flour again. And the last one is a sweet potato whole wheat pound cake, which is shakarkandi, as you like. It's really nice. So all I'm trying to say to you is think of what you eat. Okay, so I'm here with things that have changed my life, about experiences, incidents, people I have met in the internet, which has largely molded the way I think about food. To move beyond things that we think of every day, there's lots of new things waiting to be discovered as far as food goes. If you look at the first picture, for instance, it's buckwheat groats. Might sound like a very alien thing to you, but it's something a lot of people in North India or probably across India would know as fasting food, which is kuttu ka atta.
Yes.
It comes from these beautiful little pseudo cereal grains. These are things that are all very native, that are local to India. Some of these are foraged, that is, they grow in the wild. I'm not sure many of you have plucked mulberries off trees or tamarind or climbed up trees. That is stuff that we used to do when we were young. But I find that it's all gone away somewhere. We constantly eat our packaged goods, open processed foods, and we forget to think what it's doing, the harm it's doing to the environment, and the harm it's doing to our bodies. So hopefully when I go through this today, you'll find that a lot of this flavors my food. It's good for you, and it's good to get you guys thinking on what you should be doing. My moot point is, think about the origins of your food, what is on your plate, how far it might have traveled, how processed it is. Every time I open a package, that's the first thing I think about, the amount of plastic and the amount of waste we are causing to the environment and how bad your carbon footprint might be. So my thing is, I think you can eat healthy food, which is delicious. Make sure it looks good when you serve it up, because it's an entire aesthetic experience that's going to make things look good for you. I have a daughter in college. She's doing design down south, and every time she comes home, it's very strange. She comes home, it's like a ritual, as a lot of people might go to the temple. She comes home and she flings open the doors of the fridge and she goes, "Oh, there's food in here." And I keep thinking, how strange is that? Obviously, it's a fridge. And she says, "Wow, there's juice. Can I have juice? Have you made frozen yogurt? Is it mango season as yet?" And then she starts rustling through and eating, cramming as much as she can into her mouth. And then she'll say, "Have you made brownies? Where have you hidden them?" And then I think so many questions, and it's such a big deal for her, and it's something so small to me, and that is something that unites us all. It's food, and we forget to give the time it deserves, the place it needs in life. As it came closer to graduating, or maybe not out of college, I applied to every airline in Delhi. And fortunately for me, I got a job with British Airways, and out of college, I think we got out in April. In June, I joined British Airways, and eventually I became passenger services manager there. I was working on the ground, and I had a really nice time, and that's what set me up on my feet. It was a choice I made, much to the horror of my parents, who didn't know where I was. It taught me everything about life. takes me back to the days where Sir Colin Marshall was leading it. He said one thing to us when we joined. He said, there is only one constant, and that is change. Now, that is very important for you, because you know there is something to look forward to all the time. I spent some of my most precious days in British Airways. It taught me how to stand on my feet. It taught me how the world goes. It took me around the world. I met people I had never dreamt I would ever meet. I met Mother Teresa. She blessed me. She gave me a coin. I met Kapil Dev. I met John Major. I met all the English cricket teams, the Indian cricket teams, Sir Viv Richards. I met Bappi Lahiri 3 times on flights back diverted from Bombay when it was flooded, gold and all. I can't forget the door I would open and he was standing there in the first class, on the first class door each time the aeroplane came back. I don't know if a lot of you watch TV here. There's the Rocky and Mayur show. Is anybody? Yeah, okay. So Rocky was with me in British Airways. He was Sandeep at the time. I still have a tough time calling him Rocky, but I was a supervisor on a flight with him once, and the loaders went on strike. So there was Rocky flexing his muscles and me, and we loaded a whole 747 full of suitcases because the loaders were on strike, and that's all we knew. What we had to do was send the aeroplane away. We were very focused. So that's what we did. We just shoved an aeroplane, had anda toast, and that was the end of our day. Again, the same thing runs through. I met my husband at British Airways. He claimed to have cooked eggs before we got married. He has never done that till today. But the only thing he has done, he has stood by me with all the rubbish that I have done. When I got married, I didn't know how to cook. And he would stand there and eat every disaster that I produced. Whether it was the biryanis that were horrible, the kebabs that I burnt, whether it was the cake that rose like a football and crashed like a pancake. He lived through it all. I'm a lot better now. He gave me 2 sweet children, rebellious like me. I cannot say anything more about that. He also gave me the best kitchen I have. He changed macro from economics to a macro lens to my camera, which makes a lot more sense to my life now. So I always cooked and I baked. So then I started blogging. It was something that I found. The internet had just come in and I started looking around and I discovered there was something called a blog. So I started a food blog. And since baking was all that I enjoyed at the time, I named it Passionate About Baking. It's still there. I didn't give food much of a thought. I just knew I could document my recipes and put them there. So I made this little niche for myself, and I was one of the good baking blogs in India, and it kept me going. I got discovered, and one day I was at the bus stop and I was watching to pick up the kids, and every day I would watch, there was a chaiwala sitting there, and people, everybody. Daily wager, laborers, rickshaw pullers, they would go to drink chai in that plastic glass and they would eat a matri or something, and it was plain flour again. And then one day I realized we were a nation marching on empty stomachs, on calories that meant nothing. They were just empty calories, there was no nutrition. And I figured that I was guilty of doing just that as well. I had a blog, I had the responsibility, I had kids, a family, hungry mouths to feed, and I was making the same mistake that the rest of us were making. And that changed the way I looked at food, actually. I started questioning every ingredient that went into the recipes I made. Plain flour went out. That was the first thing. I told you, it's my personal punching bag. The first thing that went out was plain flour. I wanted to question why we didn't use brown sugar at home, why honey was missing, why gur was there not so often. And then I started living from season to season. So, for instance, if it was summer, my hashtag was summer is for stone fruit. I baked every fruit in the market. Crisps, crumbles, pies, everything. I had false ka ras out every day. I had jamun mousse. You can see, that's what all I did. These pictures are just of fruit and desserts because I like taking pictures of them. I cook everything. It's not to say you can't eat everything. And then, I don't know if any of you know about falsas. It's a berry, it's a really nice berry, and while we were growing up in our childhood, the falsa wala would come in the heat of summer, and with our little grubby little fingers we would pick up the berries, the tart berries. So it was something I enjoyed making, and I made it. It was the beginning of the season and I made it, and because I had so much time I took a picture. This was a picture I took, and it was on the blog, also on social media. Late that night I got a phone call, and that really knocked me off my perch. There was this lovely voice, in a very charming Punjabi voice, that said, "Hi Rabba Deva Ji, aapke false ke sharbat ne to mujhe maar dala." And then it switched over to a very crisp New York accent, Turns out it was five-star Michelin chef Vikas Khanna. And I couldn't believe it. And I thought somebody was scamming me or something. And he said, that picture, the story it says, and the nostalgia that goes with it, I can't stop looking at these pictures. And I went on to work with him. I've done a couple of TV shows with him. It's a man who wears his heart on his sleeve. He taught me the importance of a good picture, the fact that in this digital world, something good that you do has a far wider reach than you can ever imagine. So I work with him often now. One of my fondest memories is taking him to Old Delhi, and we spent a whole day there buying Purane Bartan, which is what I like to do. And I think it keeps me closer to the culture and keeps my creativity flowing. So I spent that whole day with him. As you can see there in Old Delhi, and we had chaliya, and we had everything, and we had a really nice day. And it's small incidences like this that inspire me. It was a very humble feeling to know that you can connect with different people at very different levels, and the same goes with the guy who works for me, my man Friday, as I call him, our helper at home. I know the day that he rings the bell a little louder and there is this urgency, I've given him an oven. So I know he's baked something the previous day, his kids have loved it, and he's carried samples to show me what he can do as well. He's my chief forager. He will climb mulberry trees and get me the best mulberries in the season, maybe wild figs and whatever, and that just gets you closer to the earth. You know that if you go local, there's a lot more you can do. It's very important to eat what the earth around you offers. It's trying to tell you, you're in season. Try and follow the season. In summer, you're going to get berries. They're full, they're fresh, they're happening. In winter, you'll get foods that'll keep you warm, soups and stuff. Try and stick to the earth. Try and keep it going. To start thinking more as to what you're doing, not to be so habit-oriented as we were when we were young. If we were given something, we would just eat it. We wouldn't question. It's changed now. My mother never loved cooking. She would only cook when people came. And as the earlier speaker said, we're very rebellious. We will never do what our parents do. So I'm just like that. Those are little tea cakes that I've made. Whole wheat, ginger, cinnamon, jaggery and stuff. And I put them out on the net, and it was very surprising to see the next day that so many people remade them and kept talking about them, and I loved the reactions it evoked. And I thought it was just a simple recipe, a really popular recipe, something that I recreated. So I'm not asking you guys to stop eating. I'm not asking you to, I'm just saying don't eat unhealthy. It's going to change how your life is. I haven't talked to you about quark as yet. That's my pet ingredient, something that I love. It's just an Austrian curd cheese. It's as easy as setting curd at home. You need two ingredients. You just need milk and buttermilk, and it sets like curd. You should research it, try it, thank me for it later. But it goes very well in desserts. So my mood point is, let's start eating a little better. Let's think. As I hop from Instagram to Pinterest, as I take pictures, which is what my life has become, it's about moderating what you do. I love the samosa still, how much ever I might hate plain flour. Samosa is one thing that keeps drawing me back to the bone. But all I say is that food is good. Make it make you feel happy. It looks great. Present with pride, silent well too. And I just think that you can just keep reinventing and inspiring yourself. Follow your passion and take yourself where your heart goes. And I mentioned the buckwheat groats right somewhere in the beginning. I made some biscotti out of it. It's not, you don't need to make dal chawal and khichdi out of everything. There's lots you can do. I've got some in my bag, so you can catch me later. Thank you so much for having me on.